यूनिट वन कंटेक्स्ट एंड इमर्जेंस ऑफ गांधीयन फिलोसॉफी कंटेंट्स ऑब्जेक्टिव्स इंट्रोडक्शन कंटेक्स्ट गांधी इन द इंडियन पॉलिटिकल एरियाना इमर्जेंस एज एन ऑल इंडिया लीडर लेट अस सम अप ऑब्जेक्टिव्स गांधी इज वाइडली रिकॉग्नाइज्ड एज द प्री एमिनेंट थ्योरिस्ट ऑफ नॉन वायलेंट सिविल डिसोबीडियंस द लीडर ऑफ इंडिया सक्सेसफुल कैंपेन फॉर नेशनल इंडिपेंडेंस एंड एन आर्किटेक्ट ऑफ मॉडर्न इंडियन सेल्फ आइडेंटिटी ही नेवर रोट अ कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव एंड सिस्टमेटिक पॉलिटिकल और फिलोसॉफिकल वर्क इन द मोड ऑफ थॉमस होब्स और हीगल एंड द पैम्पलेट्स एंड बुक्स ही डिड राइट आर एक्सट्रीमली डाइवर्स इन टॉपिक They include criticism of modern civilization, the place of religion in human life, the meaning of non-violence, social and economic programs, and even health issues. These works are constructed upon a series of concepts, Satyagraha, Swaraj, Sarvodaya, which Gandhi elaborates into thematic strands. The unit aims to throw some light on the unique context and the advent of Gandhi into a national leader. The emergence of Gandhi played a pivotal role in the history of Indian nationalism. He took the country by storm with his novel political ideology centered on the cardinal principles of Ahimsa and Satyagraha. Armed with these ideological tools, Gandhi shouldered critical responsibilities in the momentous events that finally led India to the path of freedom. The emergence of Gandhi on the Indian political scenario was not the mere instance of another emerging new leader, but it was the rise of a whole new philosophy that permeated into every sphere of the Indian psyche. In Gandhi's political ideals were merely an extension of his spiritual tenets, which were rooted in deep humanitarian value. Gandhi's greatness lies not only within pioneering a unique fervor in Indian politics and the rise of the masses, but in the way he revolutionized the entire way of looking at politics as an extension of mankind's inherent greatness, enriched with an innate belief in and commitment to truth. No wonder he is revered as the Mahatma and has been immortalized as the father of the nation. Thus, by the end of the unit, you should have a fair idea of context and emergence of the phenomenon of Gandhi and his philosophy. Reading Gandhi with the complex nuances his work deserves. Introduction. India's freedom struggle is a long and fascinating story. It is unique in the sense that it did not descend suddenly or abruptly like a bolt from the blue, but it matured and took shape in the womb of time for more than a century. Its revolutionary character consisted not in the quantity of bloodshed, but in the quality of the changes it brought about in the political system, the socio-economic order of India. It was not a bloody revolution, but a peaceful one carried out with the unique Gandhian weapons of Satyagraha and non-violence. It was basically an ideological conflict between the emerging Indian nationalism and entrenched British imperialism. its uniqueness is to be seen in the fact that the Indian National Congress, which spearheaded the revolt against the British imperialism, was not a mere political party in any ordinary sense of the term, but it was a national liberation movement. As such, it was able to inspire and attract different groups of people with diverse, even conflicting interests, and forge a united front to fight for the liberation of India from the yoke of the oppressive colonial rule. Thus, the Indian National Movement provided a common platform for all the freedom fighters, irrespective of their race, religion, caste, class, region, language, and sex. Gandhi appeared on the political firmament of India and imparted a new momentum to the nationalist movement. Jawaharlal Nehru has described the advent of Mahatma Gandhi in his inimitable dramatic style in his book Discovery of India. He says, "And then Gandhi came. He was like a powerful current of fresh air that made us stretch ourselves and take deep breath, like a beam of light that pierced the darkness and removed the scales from our eyes, like a whirlwind that upset many things, but most of all the working of pupil mind." Gandhi's rise in Indian politics gave a new hope to the pupil. He filled the leadership void and dominated the Indian National Congress for about 3 decades, until India's independence was won. He imparted to the great national organization a new dynamic spirituality for combat, which he produced by rediscovering the long forgotten strengths of the Indian genius and affecting a synthesis between the ancient civilization of India and modern Western civilization. Under his dynamic and inspiring leadership, the masses of India stirred themselves and plunged into the nationalist movement. His identification with the common people of India in terms of their poverty, frugal lifestyle, culture, language, and religious beliefs and practices, as well as their dreams and aspirations for human dignity and good life, was so complete, sincere, and authentic that even the most stubborn and obstinate among them found it difficult to resist his call to join the nonviolent struggle for the liberation of India from foreign rule. The nonviolent non-cooperation movement launched and directed by him makes a fascinating story. Context: the development of Indian nationalism occurred in 3 separate phases, the phase of moderates and the phase of radicals. It was the 3rd phase of Indian nationalism, but that witnessed the rise of M.K. Gandhi. Let us have a brief look at moderate phase and the phase of radicals before coming to Gandhi. Moderates: the early nationalist leaders believed that a direct struggle for the political emancipation of the country was not yet on the agenda of history. What was on the agenda was the arousal of national feeling, consolidation of this feeling with the bringing of a large number of Indians into the vortex of nationalist politics and their training in politics and political agitation. The first important task was the creation of public interest in political questions and the organization of public opinion in the country. Secondly, popular demands had to be formulated on a country-wide basis so that the emerging public opinion might have an all-India focus. Most important of all, national unity had to be created in the first instance among the politically conscious Indians and political workers and leaders. The early national leaders were fully aware of the fact that India had just entered the process of becoming a nation. Indians had to be carefully welded into a nation. Politically conscious Indians had to constantly work for the development and the consolidation of the feeling of national unity, irrespective of religion, caste or region. The Indian National Movement up to 1905 was dominated by moderate leaders. They started constitutional agitation within the four walls of law. They believed that if public opinion was created and organized and popular demands presented to the authorities through petition, meetings, resolution and speeches, the authorities would concede these demands gradually and step by step. Their political work had a two-pronged direction. Firstly, to build up a strong public opinion in India to arouse the political consciousness and national spirit of the people. Secondly, the early nationalists wanted to persuade the British government and British public opinion to introduce reforms along directions laid down by the nationalists. The moderates were never resorted to rebellion, aiding or abetting a foreign invasion or resort to crime. The nationalists criticized the official policies for bringing about the run of India's traditional economic policies, for bringing about the run of India's traditional handicraft industries, and for obstructing the development of modern industries. They complained that India wealth was being drained to England and demanded that the drain be stopped. They carried on persistent agitation for the reduction of land revenue in order to lighten the burden of taxation on the peasant. They declared that high taxation to be one of the causes of India's growing poverty and demanded the abolition of the salt tax. The nationalists agitated for the improvement in the condition of work of the plantation. Dadabhai Naoroji declared that the British rule was an everlasting increasing and every day increasing foreign invasion. The basic weakness of the early national movement lay in its narrow social base. It did not penetrate down to the masses. In fact, the leaders lacked faith in the masses, describing the difficulties in the way of organizing of active political struggle. Gopal Krishna Gokhale pointed to the endless division and subdivisions in the country, the bulk of the population ignorant and clinging with a tenacity to the old modes of thought and sentiment, which are averse to all changes and do not understand change. Radicals. After 1905, nationalist movement entered the second phase during that period, one in which Indian nationalists grew more vocal and radical in their demands, boycott, resistances and demonstration where their political weapons they came to be known as the radicals. Some famous radical leaders were Lala Lajpat Rai, Bal Gangadhar Tilak and Bipin Chandra Pal. The condition for the emergence of radical nationalism and thus developed when in 1905 the partition of Bengal was announced and the Indian National Movement entered its second phase. On 20 July 1905, Lord Curzon issued an order dividing the province of Bengal into parts, Eastern Bengal and Assam, with a population of 31 million, and the rest of Bengal was a population of 54 million, consisting of Bengalis, Biharis, and Uriya. The official reason given for the decision was that Bengal was too big to be administered properly. However, the real motive behind the partition plan was the British desire to weaken the nerve center of Indian nationalism, Bengal, on communal grounds by creating a wedge between the Hindus and Muslims. The Indian National Congress and the nationalists of Bengal firmly opposed the partition to make their protest more powerful. The Swadeshi and boycott movement was launched. Swaraj for the radicals meant complete freedom from foreign control and full independence to manage national affairs without any foreign restraint. They hated foreign rule and had no faith in the benevolence of the British public or parliament. They had deep faith in the strength of the masses, and they planned to achieve Swaraj through mass action. They therefore praised for political work among the masses for direct political action by the masses. The radicals also affirmed their faith in passive resistance, mass agitation, and strong will to suffer or make self-sacrifices. The radicals advocated boycott of the foreign goods, use of Swadeshi goods, national education, and passive resistance. However, the influence of radicals was curtailed as the British government played the game of divide and rule. While suppressing the radicals, it tried to win over moderate nationalist opinion so that the militant nationalists could be isolated and suppressed. Reconciling both these strands emerged the Gandhian phase, the third phase of national movement. Gandhi launched and encouraged protest of government, boycott Swadeshi, a mass movement of non-cooperation. All these awakened the masses under his leadership for the first time on such a wide scale. This resulted in active involvement of people on national movement. He resides in the heart of millions of Indians as the father of the nation. For the path breaking role that he played, not in the Indian struggle for independence but for molding the national character and beliefs of the Indian alike. At a time when the fabric of the Indian society was tearing apart, he accomplished the Herculean task of unifying the nation. Confronted with diverse political ideology like hardline extremism, the moderate approach, and the newly emerging communist forces, the confused Indians found solace in the simple philosophy of Gandhi. He worked assiduously for the upliftment of the downtrodden like the Dalit and gave them a new identity. Women under his aegis found back their long lost confidence and activity, actively participated in the task of national cause. Gandhi with similar preservance championed the cause of the secularism as a visionary. He realized right at the onset that the real strength of India lies in communal harmony and brotherhood. Gandhi in the Indian political arena. Gandhi returned to India in January 1915. During the first year after his arrival, Gandhi did not take a public stand on any political issue because he did not want a plunge into Indian politics until he equipped himself with first-hand knowledge of the condition in India. Therefore, in accordance with the advice of his political guru Gopal Krishna Gokhale, he undertook a country-wide tour, giving as much as he received in the form of political education. This study tour took him to Shantiniketan, where he met Rabindranath Tagore. Very soon his name became as well known throughout India as the architect of Satyagraha movement against racism in South Africa, and requests started coming from various parts of the country that he should visit their place and help the people there in solving some of their local problems. Before embarking on the study tour, Gandhi had established the Satyagraha Ashram on the banks of the Sabarmati at Ahmedabad in 1916, where the families which had lived at the Ponix settlement joined him to live together as a community committed to profess, practice and propagate the message, value and discipline of Satyagraha. Besides these, Acharya Vinoba Bhave, Mahadev Desai, Acharya Kaka Kalekar, Kishorelal Mehsruwala and J.C. Kumarappa, Miss Amtul Salam and Miss Madeline Sled from England, who later took the name of Mirabai, also joined the ashram as inmates. It so happened that this year of imposed silence ended early 1916 at the time of founding of Banaras Hindu University. Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, the founder of the university, had arranged a series of lectures to be delivered by eminent person who had come for the occasion after the foundation stone and stone had been laid by the then Viceroy Lord Harding. It was Mahatma Gandhi's turn one evening, which was the first time that he spoke in public since his arrival in the country a year ago. Big leaders, English officers, Raja and Maharaja were present wearing a turban. The future Mahatma was looking like a peasant. As he started to speak, it appeared as if Mother India was beginning to unfold her long suppressed tales of woe, asserting that the poor of India were being exploited. He explained how the money for the jewels worn by Raja and Maharaja was earned by them by sucking the blood of the poor, ridiculing them for their women like just for ornament. He advised them to sell their jewels and utilize the proceeds for the well-being of the poor. He made similar observation about the capitalist. At last, he opened a scathing attack on the English as having started the exploitation of the poor, as some among the audience shouted, "Gandhiji, go on, Gandhiji, go on." The Englishman, the Raja and the Maharaja, the Rai Bahadur and the Khan Bahadur all vacated their chairs and walked away, but Gandhi went on. At last, the Maharaja of Darbhanga, a pillar of the British Empire, who was presiding, also left. As the chairs became empty, Gandhi, a firm believer in discipline despite the request of some of the audience to continue, concluded his speech. It acted, however, as an indication of what was to come. Later in 1916, Mahatma Gandhi attended the annual session of the Congress held at Lucknow. This session, presided over by Ambika Charan Majumdar, was unique in many respects. It saw the reuniting of the radical and moderate groups. It also brought about an understanding between the Muslim League and Congress for joint fight and drew up a constitution for the Congress which had been without any during the last 30 years of its existence. However, by this time, Gandhi had been able to enter into many hearts and reserve a special place for himself there. He had also become able to earn the title Mahatma all round the pandal, where the subject committee meeting of the Congress was being held. There was constant shouting of Mahatma Gandhi ki jai in this Congress session. Some persons from Bihar met Gandhi and spoke to him about the hardship the workers were suffering at the hands of British indigo planters. Gandhi gave voice to the cause of the oppressed cultivators in Champaran district of Bihar, who were suffering under tyranny of the European indigo planters. Check your progress one, not use this page provided for your answer. Number one question, compare and contrast moderates and radicals. Number two question, did the South African experience help in advent of Gandhi?